Dobrodošli u Promjenu okvira, emisiju u kojoj ukazujemo na neke od ključnih društvenih fenomena sadašnjice te na njihove političke i ekonomske dimenzije. U 51. epizodi s Johnom Bellamyem Fosterom, marksističkim ekologom i profesorom sociologije na Sveučilištu u Oregonu, urednikom nezavisnog socijalističkog časopisa Monthly Review te autorom brojnih studija, među kojima je i nedavno kapitalno djelo The Return of Nature, Socialism and Ecology, razgovarali smo o materialističkim i dijalektičkim aspektima ekologije, tržišnoj učinkovitosti, pravednoj ekološkoj tranziciji, globalnoj rezervnoj armiji jeftine radne snage, pandemiji COVID-19 i teoriji socijalne reprodukcije. Online intervju je snimljen u kolovozu ove godine.
Koji su temelji materialističkog poimanja odnosa prirode i društva i zašto je to pitanje relevantno u borbi za okoliš?
Philosophically, materialism means the rejection of any teleological perspective or notion of final causes. Interpretations of the world that are of a religious or idealistic character. In the materialist view, the world is not predetermined, but rather is the product of contingent events rooted in changing material relationships. Hence the world is seen in terms of itself, as in evolutionary theory. All natural science is based on a materialist conception of nature. Marxism added to this materialist conception of nature a materialist conception of history, that is of society, rejecting the abstract idealism and individualism that dominated in the social sciences and still does. There's a distorted mechanical materialism, which ends up reducing things to fixed external relations. A meaningful materialist outlook, however, requires a dialectical perspective, one that captures interdependence, contradiction, movement, and transcendence. It was this combination of a materialism and dialectics that was the particular contribution of Marxian theory to science, extending to the natural sciences themselves. In terms of the ecological aspect, Engels wrote that nature is the proof of dialectics. His meaning, though, would be better understood today if we said ecology is the proof of dialectics. All ecological thought is necessarily dialectical as well as materialist. It addresses the complex interrelations and changes within nature and with nature and society viewed as evolving systems. There can be no meaningful environmentalism without this. And so ecology is basically both materialist and dialectical. And that's the reason why socialists have played such a fundamental pioneering role in the development of ecology.
Kako dovesti u pitanje mit o prirodnom kapitalizmu na koji se oslanjaju mnogi borci za okoliš u potrazi za rješenjem energetskih i klimatskih kriza putem zelene revolucije temeljene na tehnološki učinkovitim multinacionalnim korporacijama u konkurenciji na slobodnom tržištu?
The notion of natural capitalism arose with Paul Hawken and others like Emery Lovins, but Paul Hawken is the key theorist. It's basically the notion that, well, the market is efficient, but capitalism doesn't encompass all of nature because there aren't prices on natural environmental services, natural resources, natural goods are not properly priced by the market. So if you can extend the market to everything in existence and to commodify nature as well, then it will all operate efficiently on market terms and there won't be any environmental problem. I argued against Hawken from the beginning with respect to this idea. It's fallacious. It's true that some species and ecosystems, let's say songbirds and their habitat, are destroyed by capitalism because it places no value on them, but it's also the case that ecosystems and, for example, forest ecosystems are destroyed because capitalism has commodified them, has put prices on them. The market is only efficient in a very, very narrow sense in terms of conditions of capitalist profitability, the tyranny of the bottom line. That kind of efficiency has nothing to do with ecological sustainability or even with human development. If you reduce everything to the logic of the market, ultimately you will even speed up the ecological devastation. Certainly it will not help, because the purpose of capitalism, capitalism is a system of capital accumulation. It's geared to exponential growth and accumulation and economic growth, and at the expense of everything else in existence. Simply expanding market principles to the whole of nature in so-called natural capitalism is not going to help one iota in terms of ending capitalism's creative destruction of the earth.
Realnost ograničenih planetarnih resursa u oštroj je suprotnosti s kapitalističkom ekonomijom koja prisiljava sindikate i lijeve aktere da svoja politička stajališta o ekologiji usklade s developmentalističkom paradigmom te imperativom kompetitivnosti i rasta o kojem ovise plaće njihovih članova. Kako pomiriti developmentalizam i ekologiju u klasno utemeljenom lijevom odgovoru na problem klimatskih i ekonomskih kriza?
The strategy for unifying labor and ecology under present conditions has necessarily focused on a massive ecological conversion to more sustainable systems, whether in the form of a People's Green New Deal or an outright ecological revolution. All such strategies rely on the now widely recognized principle of a just transition, placing emphasis on the meeting of the essential needs of labor and other frontline communities. There's no possibility of an ecological conversion that doesn't deal with the problems of class and with frontline communities like people of color, indigenous populations, and so on. Of course, a so-called capitalist and developmentalism creates permanent contradictions in this area, and so the only meaningful long-term strategy is one that will pose the logic of capital accumulation and define the struggle straightforwardly in terms of the needs of humanity and the earth. The main potential for this, I believe, or I would argue, is the emergence of an environmental proletariat, of which there are signs, in which ecological and economic devastation are recognized as mutually reinforcing ecological contradictions, material contradictions under capitalism, and that it's necessary now to struggle against them both at the same time. We really depend on the emergence of a movement that places its emphasis on the two conditions of socialism in the 21st century, that's ecological sustainability and substantive equality.
Možete li pojasniti vezu između imperializma i globalne rezervne armije te njezina priključivanja svjetskom tržištu kao jeftine radne snage, o čemu pišete u knjizi The Endless Crisis s Robertom W. McChesneyem?
What we can call late imperialism is closely associated with a globalization of production, largely at the end of the 20th century, the beginning of this century, with the majority of the world's industrial production now occurring in the global south and shifting away from the triad of the United States and Canada, Europe and Japan. The mechanism of this is, of course, the agency is the multinational corporations that are primarily based in the center of the world economy. Production is being carried out for them, increasingly various forms of offshoring and surrogate production. Unit labor costs in the global south are much lower than in the north. The wages are extremely low in the south, and the rates of productivity are increasingly comparable to those in the north, since they're using the technology from multinational corporations. The bulk of the surplus is siphoned off and is drained away, ends up in the coffers of primarily finance in the north. So you have a situation where there's a systematic exploitation of labor in the south by the north. Samir Amin calls this a system of imperial rent. Within mainstream analysis, it's called the global labor arbitrage, but it means the same thing. As Marx explained in Capital, what pulls down the wages of workers within industry and is the reserve army of labor unemployed and underemployed workers that compete for jobs and pull down wages generally. So this competition within the working class is the secret of capitalism's control over labor and its ability to exploit at high levels. And we found that using the ILO data, that in 2011, the global reserve army consisted of 2.4 billion people, while this compared to an active labor army in the world of 1.4 billion. So the global reserve army is 70% bigger than the active labor army, and most of the global reserve army is in the global south, although it also naturally exists in the north as well, and is the key to exploitation here. One of the reasons why the capital is able to maintain this huge global reserve army in the south is immigration laws that prevent the mobility of workers from south to north. Capital is internationally mobile, but labor is not. And this creates this system of imperial rent. And this is the core of imperialism in our time.
Kako se u tu priču uklapa nekapitalistički rat?
It's still the case that about half of the world's working population are subsistence labor. And that means that they essentially survive on their own by working the land, what we call peasantry. The project of the World Bank has been to remove these people from the land, declaring that they're below the world poverty line, and so they should be eradicated. But the world poverty line is stipulated based on monetary income, so it makes these people look poorer than they actually are, since they're subsistence producers. Subsistence producers are ecologically quite vital in maintaining the conditions of the earth. The plan of global capital is to move them off the land, and this has been happening in the greatest shift in world population in world history. The plan is to move them off the land and replace them with agribusiness. These populations are part of what Marx called the latent reserve army of labor, and as they're moved off of subsistence production, they end up in the slums of the third world, what Mike Davis called the planet of slums, and they end up directly holding down the wages of the relatively small part of the population that is the active labor army. Most of the subsistence workers are women, you know, but yeah, women are part of this large latent reserve army. Women who are working for no pay.
Teoretičarke socijalne reprodukcije Titi Batačarija, Cinzia Aruza, Susan Ferguson i druge iznose suvremenu antikapitalističku feminističku kritiku političke ekonomije, koristeći marksistički teorijski okvir, ali i nadopunjujući Marksa u temeljnom pitanju. Ako su radnici ključni u proizvodnji viška vrijednosti za kapitaliste, tko proizvodi, reproducira i regenerira radnike? Na tragu vaše knjige s Bretom Clarkom, The Robbery of Nature, kakvu bi vrijednost perspektiva koja naglašava relevantnost socijalne reprodukcije mogla imati za suvremeni antikapitalistički ekološki pokret?
In modern economics, in our whole system of accounting in GDP, the labor that occurs in the household, mainly carried out by women, that's unwaged, it isn't included in GDP, just like it isn't included in Marx in value analysis. Women are brought into the exploited workforce and constitute a very large portion of it, but they're even a bigger proportion of the expropriated workforce and kept outside of capitalist value relations, which is a fundamental key to their oppression and is rooted in the whole patriarchal system when capital needs them for its value-based production, it will enlist them, but it's able to do so at lower wages because the unemployment and underemployment of women is so much greater. In Marx's time, women were the bulk of the industrial proletariat in the main value sectors of industry. The textile industry, and Marx took note of that on various occasions. So the exploitation of women was analyzed, but Marx did not go into detail into the conditions of women within the household, their reproduction, the fact that they were unwaged, and what the consequences were of that for the whole system. And this is what social reproduction theory does. In our analysis, You have to have the concept of expropriation. This is used by Nancy Fraser as well, that basically women's labor in the household is expropriated, that is robbed. It isn't exploited within the normal context of wage labor, it's expropriated, which in many ways is worse. This effectively increases the overall rate of exploitation, because women's labor is, domestic labor is sort of a free gift to capital, just like nature is treated as a free gift to capital. This actually connects up to ecological questions where nature is expropriated. It connects up to the history of slavery and various forms of expropriation of a human corporeal existence. The revolution in Marxian theory that's going on now, in which social reproduction theory has been playing a leading role, is aimed at bringing all of these things together.
Kakve bismo odgovore na aktualnu situaciju pandemije COVID-19 mogli pronaći unutar paradigme ekološkog marksizma? Koliko je naš ekonomski i ekološki status quo pogodovao širenju ove vrste zoonotskih bolesti?
Socialist epidemiological studies are long standing. Something I deal with in my book The Return of Nature, Socialism and Ecology. Marx's friend Lancaster, who was the most distinguished biologist in England in the generation after Darwin. He also worked with Louis Pasteur. Lancaster was the first to point out the human social origin of all diseases, and to actually trace this to capitalist relations. Engels's condition of the working class in England was primarily an epidemiological study that looked at how disease and illness was imposed on the working class. That was its primary emphasis. Engels called it social murder. Norman Bethune the great Marxist doctor who joined in the Spanish Civil War on the Republican side and went and helped Mao's forces in China, called the epidemiological conditions introduced by capitalism the second sickness. Marx himself designated periodical epidemics. Based on Engels's work, he designated periodical epidemics as an instance of the metabolic rift and examined epidemiological conditions in England in his time, using the main works by John Seaman and others. The leading epidemiologists in the world who are addressing these problems come out of the historical materialist tradition, have incorporated all of these ecological analyses, including the metabolic rift theory. People like Rob Wallace, and who wrote Big Farms Make Big Flu. Rob Wallace and his colleagues have developed this approach called Structural One Health, which is based on epidemiology and informed by historical materialism, that looks at how agribusiness has destroyed the buffers between natural systems and human society, creating a culture for the development of zoonoses, how the feedlots, the massive feedlots, are a conduit for the spread of the new zoonoses like COVID-19 and others, and to how this is connected to capitalist commodity chains and to the destruction of public health facilities related to neoliberalism.
Jedan od odgovora na pitanje neodrživog rasta nudi se iz polja teorija i praksi degrowtha, odnosno odrasta. Međutim, u članku u Monthly Review pod naslovom Capitalism and Degrowth, an Impossibility Theorem iz 2011. godine kritizirate projekt odrasta na račun kratkovidnosti kojom pristupa pitanju kapitalizma. Koji su glavni problemi s odrastom?
The degrowth theory can take many different forms, and in the article you mentioned, I was mainly responding to the ideas of Serge Latouche, who's very influential French degrowth theorist. And he argues that there is no incompatibility between capitalism and degrowth, which is, of course, a mystification. Capitalism is essentially a grow or die system. It's it stagnates at times, but when it stagnates, capital and stagnates, it means the pie is not growing, and capital in those periods seeks then to take a larger share of the pie, redistributing wealth and income from the poor to the rich by all sorts of means. And of course, this is what is happening under neoliberalism in a context of economic stagnation. Capitalist accumulation as a whole, the gross domestic product is the way it's measured. But that's, we talk about that as growth, but GDP or gross domestic product is just the capitalist profitability accounting raised to a national or a global level. It doesn't mean much apart from that. It's a very, very narrow conception of what matters and what growth is. Degrowth theorists don't always critique this sufficiently. They get into the trap of saying, well, instead of quantitative growth, we need quantitative degrowth. The best degrowth theorists deal with the need for qualitative change. But I think that the degrowth as a term is probably very misleading and doesn't get us at the root of the problem. It's true that the world needs what Herman Daly calls a steady state economy. Herman Daly and I have had interchanges, and he agrees with a lot of the arguments that I put forward. He's not a Marxist, very critical of Marxism, but he makes an allowance for eco-socialists who recognize the essential problem. The capitalist economy is now creating capital accumulation, growth, and waste on a level that is creating a rift in the biogeochemical cycles of the planet. And all science tells us that this can't go on. Marx, when he, in his most comprehensive definition of socialism and the freedom and necessity under socialism in volume 3 of Capital, I think it's page 959 of the Penguin edition, argues that the associated producers have to rationally regulate metabolism between humanity and nature so as to conserve their energy and promote the fullest human development, not development where quantitative growth or industrialization or anything like that was the goal, but really the development of human beings in sustainable relation to their environment. We should be able to move in that direction by promoting an anti-capitalist logic within the present system, but that struggle has to take us beyond the system if we are going to save humanity and save the earth as a human habitat.